It's a new day. Come on, Outback. Welcome, everyone, to the jewel of Central Florida, Tampa, where you're watching the Outback Bowl, part of Capital One Bowl Mania. On an irradiant afternoon here at Raymond James Stadium, it's the first meeting all time between Mississippi State and Iowa, the SEC against the Big Ten. Hello, everybody. I'm Mark Jones alongside Dusty Dvorak, Molly McGrath down to the field. From all of us at ESPN to all of you at home, we're going to declare right now, at this moment, 2019, partner, going to be the best year ever of college football.
Let's get this thing going. Let's get it kick-started.
And speaking of superlatives, what about that Mississippi State defense?
Oh, they're unbelievable. I think it could be the best defense in all of college football. They led the country this year in scoring defense, and they've got three different All-Americans. All will be on display today. Defensive line safety going to be getting after it. And T.J. Hockenson, the Mackey Award winner for Iowa, he is going to be playing today, and they're going to need him to step up and show out to try to put up some points against this unbelievably aggressive and stingy Mississippi State defense.
Yeah, daunting task for Mississippi State defensively. Molly McGrath, I would just want to say one thing. Our college football season started with you coming into a stadium on a motorcycle. It's been a great year. What do you got downstairs?
Who knows what I'll get up to today, Mark, but one thing we're looking out for is Jeffrey Simmons. He told me every morning he wakes up, looks in the mirror, and reads a poem titled See It Through. He even recited it to me word for word and told me that's the motto he lives by. That's the reason why he never even contemplated missing this final game with his teammates. You know, ahead of the bowl, he announced his intent to both play in this bowl game and declare for the NFL draft because he wanted to avoid any distractions, focus on winning. And in addition to a win, his objective today to be the Outback Bowl MVP, and this is a goal written down on a sheet of paper that he, of course, has taped to his bathroom mirror, Mark.
Great story, Molly, and certainly inspired to sprint through the tape.
Had a chance yesterday to come out to practice. I talked with Jeffrey Simmons. Just so glad he's playing. Montez Sweat, Jonathan Abram, all these guys, potential first-round draft picks, could have set out, but they want to see it through, finish this season on the right note, send these seniors out the right way. And I can assure you, all these guys recognize they've got a chance to finish this season as the number one scoring defense in all of college football. None of these guys have lost sight of that.
Well, Iowa won the toss, deferring to the second half. The Bulldogs will receive. Malik Deer and Dedrick Thomas back deep for Mississippi State. And we're underway in 2019, the first college football game of the new year. Thomas on the return. Broke a couple of tackles and is finally brought down at the 17-yard line. Nick Fitzgerald has an opportunity to become the first Mississippi State quarterback to win three bowl games as a starter. He has been through a lot of tumult in his career. The former backup to Dak Prescott has seen a lot of his up and downs, finally seen a breakthrough here late in the season. In the last five games, 11 touchdown passes, no interceptions. First down and 10 from the 17-yard line. Kylan Hill beside him in the backfield. And Fitzgerald completing his first pass to the tight end, Justin Johnson, as we take a look at today's Chick-fil-A impact players.
We got to get started with Kylan Hill. He's a home run hitter at running back. We had him week two. He was the National Player of the Week, and Elgton Jenkins might be the highest rated center as it relates to the National Football League. And the other side, Anthony Nelson, 9.5 sacks, led the Big Ten, and Amani Hooker was the defensive back of the year in the Big Ten.
Here's Kylan Hill, the guy you were alluding to a moment ago. He took the first play of the game of their season offensively for a touchdown, this time stopped up by Hockaday. Little linebacker for the Hawkeyes. Third and 5 coming up.
We talked about this Mississippi State defense off the top. This Iowa defense, very good too, led the Big Ten in scoring defense. And let's see if they can create some pressure here on third down.
It's Gerald in his first year in Joe Moorhead's offense. Has really found his rhythm the last five games of the season. Over the middle, incomplete, broken up at the 30-yard line. Good play by Jake Gervais, It was intended for Justin Johnson, so fourth and five. The Bulldogs will have to punt. Moorhead, his first year on the sidelines as head coach, former head coach at Fordham and offensive coordinator at Penn State, where he was the two-time national offensive coordinator of the year. And just the second Mississippi State coach in school history to get to a bowl game in his first year. Tucker Day punting. That's Kyle Groeneweg back deep at his own 39. Back pedals and calls for the fair catch to the 29-yard line. It'll be first down and 10 as Nate Stanley faces the D block.
His defensive line is nasty. They're deep. They go 11 to 13 players and two of the best in all of college football with Jeffrey Simmons, Montez Sweat up front. This defensive line is the engine, the catalyst of this Bulldog defense.
There's a look, one of the guys in the middle. Sweat not starting the game. He's on the sidelines for the first play anyway. Simmons out there. Stanley, the quarterback, including 59% of his passes on the season. You see a lot of two-back formation, and there's a look at some of that defense. Simmons setting the tone on the first play of the game. Sack Sargent for a loss on the play of three.
Well, he's a one-gap defender. Watch him right here. It's going to be a scoop play. Watch him as he plays down the line of scrimmage, stays active, and plays in the backfield with a tackle for loss to set the tone of this football game by Jeffrey Simmons. He said he wanted to play, and man, did he show up on the opening snap.
He told Molly he wanted to win the Outback Bowl MVP. Doesn't do a lot of talking. He's quiet. His game does most of the speaking for him. Here it is on second down. Gain of about two on the play. That's Sargent as we take a look at today's Chick-fil-A impact players. Hoyt made the stop.
We've told you about so many guys. Mekhi Sargent's really emerged as the running back for Iowa. 200-yard games to close out the season. Watch on third down. Nick Easley, an outstanding possession wide receiver. Gary Green's a senior. Played a ton of football here for Mississippi State. Errol Thompson, a big hitter and thumper at linebacker for the Bulldogs.
Third down. This is usually where they like to look towards Noah Fant, who's not playing in the game, elected not to play. Projected as a high draft pick. Hawkinson is available today, and it's a sack. Simmons there again, back at the 15-yard line. He had some company with Rivers.
This Mississippi State defense, man, they flat out get after you. They're going to bring a lot of pressure all day. No pressure needed here. You see Jeffrey Simmons on the inside, Chauncey Rivers as well. This Iowa offensive line only allowed 13 sacks all season, but they will face their biggest test of the year here today. Massive win initially for the Mississippi State front.
Okay, Dusty, a couple of three and outs by both offenses. First team to three wins. Is that the way this is going
to
look?
Expect the punters to get quite a bit of work today, my friend.
Okay. High spiral, bounces at the 42. That's Deer fielding it, and he's brought down immediately right around the 35-yard line. First down and 10 for Nick Fitzgerald. The sandy tropical beaches of Central Florida. Welcome to Tampa. Back after this. This was Jeffrey Simmons in warm-up. You see the T-shirt. That T-shirt is not telling any lies. He's creating some havoc up front, Dusty.
Speaking the truth here early, the T-shirt says it all. Jeffrey Simmons, he came to play.
First down for Nick Fitzgerald. Hands it off to Kylan Hill. Trying the left side of that offensive line. Running over Island and Williams. Stopped up by Hesse. Picks up four on the play. Hill was the team's leading rusher. Almost 700 yards on the season.
This Iowa front, it's very talented as well. Anthony Nelson, an outstanding defensive end. Also, Matt Nelson inside. They've got size. They've got length. Did a nice job shutting down opposing teams' rushing attacks all season. A real test here today.
Tough to miss that guy, Anthony Nelson, at 6'7". Second and six. Fitzgerald keeps it. And there goes the leading SEC rushing quarterback all time down to the 45-yard line. Picks up the first down on the 16-yard run.
This will be the key to the game for Iowa. Can they slow down Nick Fitzgerald as a runner? I love the patience here by Nick Fitzgerald. Allows his blocks to set up, finds the hole, cuts back. And a nice game for the first down of the ball game.
Keaton Thompson in it back, the backup quarterback. Handoff goes once again to Williams. And Williams close to the 30-yard line. Thompson and Fitzgerald, both quarterbacks on the field right now. And the handoff is to Thompson. Keaton Thompson tackled at the 28-yard line. Kirk Ferentz, 19 years on the sidelines. This is his 20th now at Iowa. He turned this program around, folks. There's no way to overstate what he's meant to Iowa City and Iowa football. His first season, 1-11. 21 games and a pivotal win against Penn State later. They've never been the same.
A model of consistency in his sixth time here in the Outback Bowl.
Third down and three. Fitzgerald fires complete to the edge. That's Thomas. And he's brought down short of the first down. The ball came loose. But they're going to rule that he was down. 2 yards short of the first down.
That's an outstanding tackle out in space by Amani Hooker. I mentioned earlier, won the Tatum Woodson Big Ten Defensive Back of the Year Award. He's playing in the nickel now that Geno Stone has come aboard. That's a tough play to make out in space on Dedrick Thomas, a guy who's slippery and can easily make you miss. Outstanding job making the tackle and getting the defense off the field.
And as a result, Dusty, Jace Chrisman comes into the ballgame trying to attempt this field goal from 43 yards out, 9 of 13 on the season. From 44 yards out. And the Bulldogs on the board first, 3-0. Now 10 of 14 on the season. Time out of the field. Back to sunny and warm Tampa right after this. Mississippi State with a 44-yard field goal by Jace Chrisman. They lead 3-0. Just underway here in the first quarter, the first meeting all time between Mississippi State and Iowa. Folks, lots of activities and fun happening in and around the bowl for the last week. Teams have been down here for several days, came down the day after Christmas. They've been enjoying a lot of the weather. On the return, this is Smith Marset, first in the conference in the Big Ten in kickoff return yardage, and a nice run out to the 34. Out of the backfield, Sargent brought down for a loss on the play. That's the guy that Dusty talked about in the open, Jonathan Abram. Knifing in there to make a great tackle.
Well, this guy plays an extremely high level, high energy guy. He's a throwback player. It's big collisions, and you're going to see him just come in off your screen. He's out of the screen. He's going to come in and just get him on the ground. Plays with reckless abandon, and we'll be talking about him throughout the day, but I know Bob Shoup and him have developed a very close relationship, and he's really been the straw that stirs the drink here on this defense.
Sets up a 2nd and 16 on the loss of 6. Stanley throws that nice out to the wide side of the field. Smith Marset making the reception and taking exception. A little roughhousing.
Well, Mark, Nate Stanley admitted to me that the thumb on his throwing hand still isn't 100% healthy. You can see today it's wrapped with tape. He called it a nagging injury that won't go away, but it's not in any pain, but told me he noticed he doesn't have the same release on the ball. It sometimes slips a little bit. He's forced to grip the ball a little differently, so we'll definitely look for that today, Mark.
Interesting news. There's a look at it right there.
And since that injury against Penn State, 7 touchdowns, 1 interception, he's played much more efficient.
Throws a completion to Easley. Nick Easley makes the catch. Brought down immediately by C.J. Morgan. And that's going to be a 4th down, short. Good defense once again by the number one scoring defense in the country, Mississippi State. Simmons leading the way. That's the 2nd 3-and-out for
Shoup,
Iowa.
Bob Shoup dialed up another pressure. Nate Stanley had enough time to find easily his favorite target on 3rd down, but well short of the sticks. And once again, nice job rounding to the football, tackling by Mississippi State.
That's Tedder on that rollout rugby stop punt. Fielded cleanly. Wow, what a catch at the 47-yard line by Aaron Brule. That thing was coming at him hot. Good set of hands. 12-yard punt. Nothing on the return, but fantastic field position as a result for Mississippi State. Williams. Nice gain over 30, brought down at the 29-yard line, picked up about six.
Mark Fitzgerald told me he's most proud of the way that he's handled that adversity, from injuries to coaching changes. He went through ups and downs, but stayed mentally tough and told me he wants to be remembered as one of the toughest players to ever wear a Mississippi State uniform.
I think he's going to get that distinction. Yeah. He is a tough football player. Think about it. From the injury you described to a 1,000-yard season and 12 rushing touchdowns and a league as tough as the SEC, you got to be hard-nosed and tough.
That's well-earned. Fitzgerald again. And he picks up another first down. Tim Tebow is looking up at Nick Fitzgerald on the SEC quarterback rushing charts. You know, it was interesting to hear him say that amongst the people that phoned and got in contact with him and offered encouragement through his rehab and recovery from his gruesome ankle injury was none other than Gordon Hayward of the Boston Celtics, who went through the same thing last year. Fitzgerald over the middle, had a man, and incomplete through the hands of Keaton Thompson.
The quarterback playing slot receiver. He was open, working right up the seam, zone coverage in the back end by the Iowa Hawkeyes, and Keaton Thompson found a little daylight in that zone coverage, and good throw by Nick Fitzgerald, just a drop by the backup quarterback.
Yeah, he should have had that.
You know, Nick Fitzgerald's really done a better job of understanding these passing concepts, where to go with the football the last five games of this season.
Second and 15, out of the backfield. Good catch by Williams and turned it north-south, tiptoes out of bounds at about the 25. Thomas threw him a nice block. Well, ESPN Plus is your home for more sports, more schools, more conferences, more ESPN. Start your free trial today by downloading the ESPN app or visiting ESPNplus.com. I'm just inside the 25 after a gain of six. Third down and nine. Bulldogs making their first appearance in the Outback Bowl. Into the end zone, and incomplete. Gervas broke it up. And Jesse Jackson was in behind him with nobody close to him, Dustin.
Well, that time Iowa brought a blitz, and Aris Williams did a nice job stepping up in there and picking up the protection. Plenty of time for Nick Fitzgerald. He underthrew his intended target in the corner of the end zone. And a nice break on the ball by the senior safety, Jake Gervas, playing his final game as an Iowa Hawkeye, getting his defense off the field.
It's a good win for the Hawkeyes defensively. This one coming from 42 yards out. Made one earlier from 44. Chrisman now 2 for 2 in 2019. So they were able to cash in some points off of that short punt.
Literally was a great year for Iowa, and you know, 8-4 season, and I think they're a better football team than the record indicates. I thought after we had them midway through the season at Maryland, they would win the Big Ten West. They go on to lose three straight in three games. They could have easily won Penn State, Purdue, Northwestern, all games. They were right there at the very end, but found a way to lose. And I give this team credit to senior leadership for finishing the season the right way. And that was a special win to cap off the year against Nebraska with a walk-off field goal.
Yeah, Ferentz talked about the tipping point being that his team had the spirit and temerity to continue to work hard, albeit those three losses could have been debilitating. 45 seconds to go here, and this Iowa Hawkeye offense hasn't gotten any rhythm yet. Kelly Martin getting a touch this time. Simmons wreaking havoc on that defensive front.
Brian Ferentz needs to have a long conversation with his offense. The Iowa offense needs to get something going. Running the football through the air, first downs need to be had as we get ready to start the second quarter.
Hey, South Dubuque Street, that kiss is for you, Iowa City. Well, the Outback Bowl is proud to host its 33rd game today. That's right. Over its history, it's become a true Tampa Bay treasure, generating $148 million for universities, $1 billion in economic impact for the Tampa Bay region. So many great things to do here. Clearwater Beach, St. Pete's Beach.
Awesome city.
Oh.
Second straight year here at this bowl and in this city. It's a fantastic event.
A lot of those Iowa and Mississippi State fans with their toes in the white sand yesterday. Nowhere to go. Boy, that defense has been staunch, intransigent, impenetrable. Dantzler that time, along with Kobe Jones, and a flag down in the field on the loss.
Number 52, throat slap. 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
A little taunting. They're going to get 52 Kobe Jones. I think he said it was a throat slash.
Yeah.
Sportsmanlike conduct. It's Mississippi State already with its third tackle for loss of the day. That's a school record. I've talked about this aggressive attacking style defense, but a penalty that I'm sure Joe Moorhead not very happy about. Really the only thing Iowa has had positive going their way offensively so far today.
Sargent in the backfield on first down and 10. Over the middle. Caught. Nick Marcet still on his feet. Reverses field. There's a flag down on the far side of the field. Now he's down at the 48. He ran about 40 and picked up. Well, he's right around the line of scrimmage.
Pads popping down there. A couple of missed tackles. No one wrapped up, but you can see the way this Mississippi State defense runs to the football.
Personal foul, targeting, defense number 8, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
That's going to go against Maurice Smitherman. First down and 10 for the Hawkeyes. The deepest they've been in Mississippi State territory all game. Run it into the boundary, down to the 33. Sargent brought down by Braxton Hoyett. Well, you can hear the echoing of the cowbells resonating, not from Starkville, but from right here in Tampa. The officials for this game have allowed cowbells to be brought in and used by Mississippi State Bulldog fans.
You can use it, but you can't abuse it, right? That's
whatever
what
that means.
That's right. Trying to make some noise here in Tampa at Raymond James Stadium today.
Second down and 10. Little toss. And nowhere to go. Hoyett making another tackle on Sargent. Molly?
Mark, it's pretty loud down here, and Mississippi State fans know that they have to stop ringing the bells the second that the ball is under center. They're continuing to ring, and they will be issued one warning, and then they won't be able to use the bells at all for the rest of the game. So we'll keep an ear out for that one. It's definitely affecting the sound down here on the field, though.
Molly, sounds like you're saying they're abusing it, not using it right now.
Exactly.
Third and 10, ninth play of the drive.
It's an area where Mississippi State likes to bring pressure all season.
They look away from Hawkinson, come back to the other side to Easley. And Easley going to be stopped up about 2 yards short of the first down within Racino's field goal range.
This is good recognition right here by Nate Stanley. You'll see Abram, and as I mentioned, they love to bring pressure off the edge from the field. He's going to replace that with Easley on the out route. So he identified where the blitz was coming from. He hits his slot receiver in the check down and gets him in a very manageable field goal situation. Nice job by Nate Stanley. IDing the blitz early and getting the ball out quick.
Well, many people feel he'll be a really good NFL prospect. Miguel Racinos from 44 yards out, 15 of 20. On the season, and he's off to a propitious beginning here in 2019 in a game of field goals. We're planted by threes. We told you about the defense from the top, folks. What'd you expect? Back after this. Folks, the name is Molly V. McGrath.
And it should be this.
Look at
simple.
This. The V is for versatile.
How do you like that, Dusty?
I love it, Maul. Hey, she's been unbelievable all year, man.
Molly, pushing the car was the highlight for me, and the one take that you did on the Boomer Schooner.
Well, you know, that was all because of Brian Ferentz and how he teaches his offensive line. So I was just trying to put what he taught us into motion. We've had a ton of fun this year, guys. I did think about going up in the eagle's nest at the top of the ship up there, but I had no real reason So we'll see. That may be for postgame.
Hey, we still got 3.5 quarters to go. 2.5 to go, Molly. This one's going to come out to the 25-yard line. Kylan Hill in the backfield. First down and 10 for the Bulldogs. Up by 3. It's Gerald on a predetermined quarterback run. Picks up about 8 on the play. Tackled by Matt Hankins.
He just kind of picks and plods his way, doesn't he?
Yep.
He's nothing real quick about it. He just believes in his blockers. He gives them time and allows things to set up. And that big 6'5", 230 frame really knows how to run the football well.
He's run for more yards than Iowa as a team. 6 for 39. Hands it off to Hill. Hill found a crease over the right side of that offensive line and is across the 40. Hey, Monday on ESPN, Clemson and Alabama face off in the college football playoff national championship game presented by AT&T at Levi's Stadium in Santa Clara, California. 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, streaming live on the ESPN app so you can watch the game everywhere. Dusty, I'm going to ask you, who wins this one? Who do you like?
Clemson. I picked it before the year. I had Alabama, Clemson, the national title, and I had Clemson winning it all. I think it's going to be a tremendous football game. But that defensive line, that pass rush that Brent Venables and Clemson has, I think it's going to give Tua some problems. So
it's Gerald going up top, incomplete. You think
give me the underdog to win it.
Wow. You know what? I like Alabama.
Okay.
I like Tua's poise.
Lots
I think
like.
The fact that, you know, Clemson's missing some guys that count.
Dexter Lawrence.
Yeah.
We still were to find out exactly, but they still got plenty of guys. They got Christian Wilkins. They got Cleveland Furrell. I mean, they got guys. And I just think Trevor Lawrence's ability to push the football down the field to Justin Ross, to T. Higgins, and those guys they have. And don't forget, ETN, one of the most explosive running backs in all of college football. Let's face it, it's round 4. It's going to be an unbelievable national championship.
That's familiar. Hill tripped up by Anthony Nelson. Nelson led that Hawkeye defense with 9.5 sacks this year, along with Epinesa. That's going to be a loss of 1 on the play. He was second team all Big Ten.
Big time football player coming off the edge. Watch him. He penetrates. He gets in the backfield, and he's able to make the play. Tackle pulls. He gets up the field. A nice job getting Kylan Hill on the ground behind the line of scrimmage.
Remember, this Iowa Hawkeye defense led the conference, the Big Ten, in scoring defense. 3rd and 11.
Also led the Big Ten in interceptions with 18 this year. Love to get one here.
Fitzgerald, ball came loose. Recovered by the Hawkeyes. Let's see if his arm was coming forward or not.
The ruling on the field is an incomplete forward pass. Fourth down.
Epinesa made the hit. Guy who I was talking about just a moment ago with those 9.5 sacks.
Well, he might be the best of the bunch as far as the defensive ends, the best true rusher, as you're going to see him. He misses initially, counters, comes back inside, and he gets a big shot on Nick Fitzgerald as he delivers the football. A backup with 9.5 sacks and a first-team all-conference defender.
Incomplete pass, and it'll be punting situation now for Mississippi State again.
But you're exactly right. Isn't it a luxury for Phil Parker, the Iowa defensive coordinator, to be able to bring in A.J. Epinesa off the bench, slide Parker Hesse down inside to get all those, he's get 4 defensive ends on the field at one time to rush the passer?
That's Kyle Gronewig, first in the Big Ten in punt returns. Had a touchdown earlier this year against Illinois, calls for the fair catch at the 25-yard line, a 34-yard punt, and nothing on the return. Well, conspicuous by his absence for the Hawkeyes today, Noah Fant, one of the top tight ends in the country. More on him on the other side of this. Stick around.
Well, the Hawkeyes are out without one of their biggest weapons on offense today. Noah Fant, who's projected by our Todd McShay as the number one tight end in the upcoming NFL draft. A freak athlete, 42-inch vertical. He's got a tight end frame, but a wide receiver skill set. And he is not here a part of this offense. And you would think with his absence, you'd see a bigger role for T.J. Hockenson, the Mackey Award winner, who we've yet to see him with a touch here today.
Cupboard's not empty. Downfield wide open, easily. Room service, touchdown. 55 yards. Stanley to Easley. And in one play, the Hawkeyes take the lead.
Play action pass. And defensive players with their eyes in the backfield. And Nate Stanley finds a wide open Nick Easley. And all of a sudden, the Iowa Hawkeyes, they're in business.
Stanley with a career-long pass on that touchdown.
Well, I've been bragging on this guy all day long. Jonathan Abram, but he's going to get himself in trouble right here. Take a look at it. He's working in the nickel. Watch his eyes off the play-action pass, and he's not going to be able to run with Nick Easley. Gets caught looking in the backfield. Play-action pass. He steps up. No safety help over the top. And Nick Easley wide open with green grass out in front. And Nate Stanley drops a dime. And the Iowa Hawkeyes with their first lead of the game here in 2019.
I'll tell you what, Abram was closing on him pretty quickly. If he had five more yards, he brings him down. But you know what they say about if. And the Hawkeye fans in attendance here making a little bit of noise.
Great graphic by our guys back in the truck. I was just going to say, Mississippi State had not allowed a play of 50-plus yards all year. Nobody else in college football could state that claim no longer as Iowa with a 75-yard touchdown here in the second.
Against the number one scoring defense in the country. Murphy. And Murphy brought down at about the 21-yard line. On first down and 10, Fitzgerald surveys, throws a strike, and now they're going to say incomplete. It was knocked loose by Gervas. Well, when you look at Iowa and their program over the last 20 years, they have been a paragon, a model of consistency, invariable and inexorable. Kirk Ferentz sets the tone. He's the man that makes the tenor work for the Iowa Hawkeyes. And he said to us when we had a chance to visit with him after 20 years, it's still a lot of fun for him. Get backside pressure, fumbled, loose. Epinesa brought that smoke. And the Hawkeyes say they've got it. Iowa ball.
Well, A.J. Epinesa once again. We already saw him once with a sack and almost, or with a big hit on the quarterback and almost a sack fumble as he's going to beat Greg Island. You see him just flip his hips, turn the corner, and the ball is out. Excellent job rushing the passer. And when you get home, don't just get the sack, get the ball out. And Iowa with a huge turnover as this game and the momentum has completely turned in their favor.
With 35 sacks on the season, second in the Big Ten. Fitzgerald had it come loose, recovered by Chauncey Colston.
These tackles for Mississippi State this year, they've struggled off the edge with quality edge rushers. And we're seeing that here in the first half today.
Working with a short field. Hawkinson, the tight end at the top of your screen. Hawkinson underneath, but they come to the tailback. Torrin Young makes the catch. Well, it's the first fumble that Fitzgerald has lost in over 500 carries.
It's an amazing stat.
Yeah, pretty durable.
Wow.
Pretty safe with him holding the ball.
Tell you though, when you've got somebody like A.J. Epinesa at 6'5", 280, barreling down you from the blind side, it's tough though on the football in situations like that.
Loss of two, second and 12. Stanley, caught. Touchdown, Smith Marset. Hawkeyes able to capitalize on the fumble recovery. And for Smith Marset, that's the third touchdown catch of the season. Boy, the Hawkeyes have really come to life here in the last several minutes. They lead 17-6. Witness the precision of Hawkeye football. And on the Pet Mall, they're celebrating a little bit in Iowa City. Back after this, the consistency of the Iowa Hawkeyes football program is really commendable. Five seasons with 10 or more wins, 17 bowl game appearances. They're ranked in the top 10, five of the last 13 seasons, and the longest tenured active FBS head coach, Kirk Ferentz, who turned it around after 21 games into his tenure. 1-11 his first year. And look what they've come to. Got his son working on his staff too, which is great. Went to school at Yale. That pass complete to Osiris Mitchell. Brought down immediately by Hankins. Yeah, he loves Shoup, the defensive coordinator. Loves watching Brad Stevens, the head coach of the Boston Celtics. He admires the fact that Stevens a little bit of an outside-the-box thinker.
He's a fan of yours. He was watching you on Christmas Day. Loves those Celtics and big fan of Brad Stevens, as you mentioned. I was shocked at his basketball acumen.
Yeah.
Loves the hoops.
He can draw him up with five guys on the field, I bet, too. 8-yard gain on the last play.
Lonnie Hooker up at the line of scrimmage. Looked like he's going to be coming off the edge. I might have checked out of that.
And Hill picks up the first down. Got about three.
Mark, the temperature on the field and the temperatures of these teams are two very different things. We see that it's in the low 80s, but on the field it feels more like 90 degrees. And Mississippi State's sideline, especially defensively, has cooled down. The players are quiet and frustrated. And on Iowa's sideline, these players are so riled up, their coaches are trying to calm them down, saying, don't get too confident. You need to stay smart despite this lead.
Fitzgerald with a little over a minute to go, fires. Incomplete at the 40-yard line, intended for Justin Johnson, who has been one of his primary targets here this afternoon. There's a look at father on the left, son on the right, and it was interesting. Brian told us when we had them earlier this year that there was a situation where in a game against Michigan as a player for him, he'd been cleared to play, and he says that is the only time where I felt that he was unfair to me. And he went to his dad after the game and said, Dad, you treated me like a dad and not a coach, because he had been cleared to play and never got in the game. Pass intended for Kylan Hill, incomplete. So said that it's what, easier to play for him, though, than coach for him, right?
Yeah, he said that dad holds him to a high standard when you're coaching for him. And he told us it's difficult to live up to the example that his father sets each and every day. And he said he's reminded daily, I'll never be as good is my dad. But very cool relationship that those two share on this Iowa football team.
Third and 10. Epinesa was in there again, flushing out Fitzgerald. Caught! Mitchell still on the move! Osiris inside the 10, all the way down to the 2. With 38 seconds to go. But there's a flag down back near midfield, so hold on. The officials are talking at midfield about something.
Huge call coming up.
Holding, offense, number 70, 10-yard penalty. We play third down.
It's Tommy Champion in for Stuart Reese at right tackle. All right, there's A.J. Epinesa. Watch this dip off the edge here. Ooh, see that little dip, that slight dip? That's what forced Nick Fitzgerald to step up in the pocket. And you can see right there, 98 Nelson's getting hold. He got wrapped around. Freeze it right there, guys. See, there's the hold.
Oh, yeah.
By 70. It was an outstanding job by Nick Fitzgerald to get outside the pocket. Osiris Mitchell makes the guy miss, but That was clearly a hold by Tommy Champion and the right call by the official.
Against Florida and LSU, looking to atone for that today. Fitzgerald completes the pass out to the 45-yard line to Lee. Fourth down coming up. Iowa with two timeouts remaining, as does Mississippi State. Williams actually on that cap.
No timeout for Iowa, I guess. I guess they don't want to try to just gonna let it run out. And Iowa does receive the ball to start the second half, so they're just gonna let it roll out. Interesting. I would have figured that, you know, if they get that stop right there, just why not force them to punt the ball? You've got a great punt returner. See if you can't tack one on right before the half. Just seems like you kind of allowed that final 30 seconds to roll off, and you could have maybe even put a bigger impact on what was a fantastic first half for your ball club.
Well, Nick Fitzgerald looking for his third consecutive bowl win. No other Mississippi State quarterback has done that. And Iowa looking for their first win here in the Outback Bowl in their last three appearances. Let's go down to Molly with their head coach.
Thank you, Mark. Coach, how did your team steal back that momentum after a slow start?
Well, you know, they just kept hanging in there, and we made some big plays. Then we went one nowhere offensively in the first quarter, obviously. Defense kept us in the game, and we came up with some plays.
How do you get T.J. Hawkinson more involved in the second half?
Well, we'll keep working at that. You know, they're obviously giving him some attention, needless to say. So, you know, we just got to keep playing. It's a 60-minute game. There's a lot of football in front of us. I didn't help us on that last offensive possession. It was dumb football, but defense bailed us out.
All right. Thank you, Coach.
Thanks.
Father and son on the sidelines for the Iowa Hawkeyes. It's a family deal. Family over everything. Iowa with the lead at the break. Welcome, everyone. You're watching the Outback Bowl. Part of Capital One Bowl Mania. From beautiful Tampa, Florida. On January 1st, 2019. Yeah, it's a little toasty here in Central Florida. But down here, we just call it Tuesday. All right? Spoken like a true Florida resident. Mark Jones chopping it up with Dusty Dvorak, Molly McGrath joining us in just a bit. Mississippi State held a brief lead, and through 30 minutes of football, Dusty, really, it's boiled down to three pivotal key plays in the first half.
That's exactly right. They're game-changing type of plays for this Iowa Hawkeye football team. They had nothing going whatsoever. It was all Mississippi State early. Then a play-action pass. They hit Nick Easley wide open, right up the seam. And all of a sudden, there was life in this Iowa football team. Then they come right back, and it's A.J. Epinesa with the sack fumble. Iowa recovers it. Two plays later, look at the pinpoint accuracy, the ball placement from Nate Stanley. Those three plays have us to the point we are now. It's 17-6 Iowa. Another key part that second quarter, the penalties for Mississippi State, almost as many penalty yards as they had offensive output. Just a wild second quarter, very much in the favor of the Iowa Hawkeyes.
Yeah, Stanley completed his first eight passes of the ball game. Molly, what do you have from Mississippi State side of the field?
Well, Mark, Joe Moorhead talking about those penalties that Dusty mentioned, six penalties for 70 yards. He was extremely frustrated, said that was the first thing that they approached in the locker room and told his team, you need to approach the second half with a lot more composure. We easily could have been up by two scores if not for those mistakes. And the seniors were very upset in the locker room. They requested to speak to the entire team before the coaches spoke to them. And their message, this is it. We have no other chance. We need to win this.
Remember going back after that Florida loss, it was Jonathan Abram who spoke to the entire football team, holding everyone accountable. I wonder if a similar type of conversation was had at the break.
Yeah, he has so much gravity and weight with his teammates. So we do it again on the kickoff return. Nice alley for Smith Marset, all the way out to the 43-yard line. Well, come on. Little blitz coming off the edge, and they get to Stanley. They envelop him. And sack him. Abram, one of the first guys to get there at the 47. Had some company with Montez Sweat.
Well, they love to bring him off the edge. And we talked about this earlier. He moved into the nickel position about three games ago against Alabama. And he's just going to be coming in fly off the edge. Watch him run through the running back, Mekhi Sargent. Just throws him out of the way. And him and Montez Sweat meet at the quarterback. It's exactly what Bob Shoup and this defense needed to start the second half. Pressure and that attacking, aggressive style of defense. Big-time play by Jonathan Abram.
Second down and 17. Stanley has time, picked off. One man to beat for Gay. Willie Gay finally tackled by Stanley. First and goal, Bulldogs. The defensive play they were looking for.
And they had to have it. This defense has been the calling card for this team all year. They've stepped up when they've had to. And Willie Gay with a huge play as he reads the eyes of the quarterback, Nate Stanley. Eyes right there on him. You see him viewing the quarterback. Steps right in front of Smith Marsette. Outstanding job by Willie Gay being in the position he needs to be, reading the eyes of Nate Stanley and getting a big, big turnover as he puts on the dog collar over on the sidelines.
Willie Gay, a big part of that defense. First and goal from the six. It's Gerald with a couple blockers in front of him, and he's going to lose a couple of yards back at the eight. Hesse, Parker Hesse, making the tackle.
Nice job by Parker Hesse. Talking about seniors, another senior right there, former walk-on who's been an outstanding player for this football team. Honorable mention, all Big Ten this year in his final game as a Hawkeye, doing a nice job setting the edge and getting Nick Fitzgerald to the ground. Senior class has been fantastic for Kirk Ferentz and looking in on a high note.
13 of them playing their final game. Fitzgerald hands it off. Hill trying to get to the edge. Spins and gets down to the 1 yard line. It'll be third down and goal. Hesse again there to make the tackle on the 6 yard gain. This is where Moorhead's offensive line can have to roll up their sleeves and man up.
This is an area where we see a lot of quarterback run game. You see Colin Hill could get this football, but a lot of times Nick Fitzgerald calls his own number.
Fitzgerald out of the shotgun, Hill to his right. Hill on the toss, great move. Oh, they hit him with the sauce. Touchdown, Mississippi State.
Message heard from the Mississippi State football team from their seniors at halftime. Great job by Molly telling us that the seniors had something to say at the break. It was Jonathan Abram with a big sack, the takeaway, and they cap it off with a touchdown as Mississippi State going for two, looking to make this a field goal game here early in the second half.
Striking quickly and capitalizing off the interception by Willie Gay. It's Gerald and Thompson both on the field. Fitzgerald almost intercepted and batted down by Matt Nelson. So it remains a 5-point game. Willie Gay with a big play defensively for Joe Moorhead's team. Read it, picked it, and took it all the way down to make it first and goal where Hill took over. We'll be back to Tampa right after this.
Mississippi State capitalizing on that Willie Gay interception, and the entire sideline was celebrating, everyone except for Jonathan Abram. He sat alone, no smile on his face. He even walked over to the defensive line to critique them. He looks like a man on a mission, Dusty. And I know that you spoke with him yesterday and you saw that intensity too.
Absolutely. That's the way this guy plays. He is focused, he's dialed in. And until this game's over and they win the game, Jonathan Abram won't be satisfied.
A good celebration by the rest of his teammates there. Under attack, Smith Marsette went airborne. Wow! And McLaurin recovered the ball.
Recovered in the field with play by the kicking team. First down.
Mississippi State ball.
Wow, what a turn of events with what looks like the second turnover to start this second half. Smith Marsette dove forward, ball goes out. Looked like a helmet hit right on the football. His own player, 46, the fullback, Austin Kelly.
And Mark McLaurin recovered it in the field of play.
Smith Marset, he dives forward
time
to get
out,
more
Mississippi
yardage.
State, their first of the half.
And he runs into his own player. Ooh,
that's about as bizarre a play as you're going to see.
30 seconds.
Now the Iowa Hawkeye defense charged, but trying to find a way to get a stop.
See if they take a shot here on first down. Fitzgerald keeps it. Still on his feet. Nick Fitzgerald got to the corner. Cuts it up. Touchdown! Happy New Year, Mississippi State!
That's an outstanding job by Nick Fitzgerald.
Stayed on his feet,
just
Dusty.
Making people miss, running through arm tackles. Wow, that's a great individual effort, getting it done by himself.
A couple of guys missed tackles along the way. He had a little bit of company down the sidelines once he broke those tackles.
What an electric start to the second half here in Tampa. Nick Fitzgerald been doing a long time. You better wrap that big man up as he takes it to the house, and Mississippi State regains the lead. What you got, Iowa? You're up next.
As part of playing the Outback Bowl, both teams participating in a fun week of activities in Tampa, including polling. Guys went to check out a Lightning hockey game, and the guys got on the ice and actually had a little bit of fun. They went to Clearwater Beach and a lot more. Let's do this kickoff thing again. Smith Marset this time didn't go airborne. Didn't. Smith Marset in motion. Stanley going up top. And a flag thrown. Jonathan Abram was there covering Smith Marset. They were both seemingly jostling, but it's like we're going to get pass interference against the defense.
Jonathan Abram.
Pass interference, defense, number 41. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Sorry, Mark McLaurin, the other safety for Mississippi State. Too much contact before the pass arrived. And it was 38, Jonathan Abram. He never got turned around. He got tied up with the wide receiver. Too much contact down the field. And it's the right call by the official.
Well, Mark, T.J. Hockenson may be a little distracted in this game. He admitted to me he still doesn't know if he's going to return to school or go to the NFL draft, and you can tell he's torn up about this decision. He told me he's been turning off his phone lately, trying to drown out all the noise.
Yeah, I bet, Molly, he's attracting a lot of attention from people trying to feed him information. The Mackey Award winner playing, Noah Fant, not available today. He chose not to play in the bowl game. And, Dusty, just to present both sides of this debate, right, which is a prevailing one, a burgeoning one in college football, guys passing on bowl games, I totally understand a guy who has done all he's done to get his draft stock where it should be and doesn't feel like they want to put their future in peril. It is somewhat at times hypocritical for others to say, others who are making $6 million, $7 million a year, to say that a kid should be playing. Stanley sacked back at the 47-yard line by Simmons and Willie Gay. And Hockenson, for one, said, hey, I understand my teammate not wanting to play. I'm okay with it. It's just a personal choice, right? Is that the way it plays out?
That's the way it plays out. I agree. It's a business decision, and if you decide you don't want to play, you put yourself in a position to go make money, that's fine. I will say, I salute and respect the guys that look at this as, I'm not going to quit on my teammates. I'm going to finish the season and play it out. I'm okay if you want to say I want to be a pro, but I applaud the guys that stick it out and finish the season and play in these bowl games.
Stanley back to pass. Little backside heat coming. Iowa's bench is looking for a flag. Felt that Stanley was hit late by Montez Sweat.
Montez Sweat was barreling down on Nate Stanley here on the near sidelines. All the jawing over on the sidelines with the Hawkeye bench. making him sweat over there.
He was still in play.
I think when the initial shove happened, I think Nate Stanley was still in play. And John over there with the Iowa Hawkeyes.
There's a guy that's going to be playing on Sundays next year. Montez Sweat graduated in December without even coaching a game. And players should be able to pursue their dreams as well as they see fit. Deer on the fair catch. Sweat and Taylor.
Tell like the that, tape. Right? Pretty darn spot on, right?
Same guy.
We're going to see if Montez Sweat can do his Jason Taylor today and at the next level.
Mississippi State with a thirst-quenching lead so far. Lunging forward, Matt Nelson tripped him up. You know, speaking of Matt Nelson, number 96 on that defensive front for Iowa. Matt Nelson actually took his MCAT. There he is there. And during one of his knee procedures, he asked the doctor not to give him any anesthesia. He wanted to watch his own knee operation as Keaton Thompson comes into the ball game.
Commitment to his future craft, I would say. My goodness.
Thompson brought down after a gain of one, but he actually had a chance to watch the DVD of it. The doctor said, no, I can't do that. But, yeah, he looking to become an orthopedic surgeon when his football career is over. 6'8 out of Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Has that recording of his meniscoscope. Well, you never asked to watch your own, right?
I've had two ACL reconstructions. I want him to put me out immediately. Big third down here for this Iowa Hawkeye defense.
Fitzgerald had it tipped at the line of scrimmage. Caught, intercepted by Nelson. Anthony Nelson.
I think it was Anthony Nelson with the
tipped
tip.
It. And it looks like Iowa recovered it.
Chauncey Golston initially looked like he intercepted the pass.
It's Iowa football. It was tipped by Nelson. There was a pack of players there. And it's Iowa football.
Iowa brought a blitz. Mississippi State was set at the wide receiver screen. The blitz comes home. Anthony Nelson gets that big paw up in the air. And then it's Golston from the inside, jumps up and gets it. A defensive lineman's dream. And we mentioned sudden change, another wow. Sudden change with Iowa getting the football back in action with a chance to take the lead here in the third.
See if they take a shot here on first down. Number 32, Stanley. Throws a rope complete to Brandon Smith, and Smith picks up the first down. 12-yard game.
After Iowa's last drive, Mark, T.J. Hawkinson was very frustrated on the sideline. He was visibly upset, and coaches were telling him to calm down and relax multiple times. He is frustrated by their inability to get him the ball, and he is letting it get to his head. Let's see how he responds on this drive.
Zeros across the board for him. That is the best tight end in the country, folks, the Mackey Award winner, T.J. Hawkinson. Non-impactful so far this afternoon. 4 minutes to go in the third quarter. Stanley under duress, and he avoids the sack, incomplete. But he took a hit.
The pass was legal. Number 12 was in the area. Second down.
No grounding there because the receiver in the area. Let's take a look at the hot topics around college football brought to you by Outback Steakhouse. Well, Noah Fant not playing today. How much do you think they're missing him?
Absolutely. He's a big piece of their offense. Talking with Brian Ferentz, he said he's their number three option. They're having to change a lot of the sets they get in and where they like to go with the football. No doubt it's had an impact with his absence.
Bryce Love also sitting out the bowl game. Stanford got the win yesterday. Second down and 10. Stanley on the out pattern. Complete to Smith-Marset. And it's going to be 3 yards short of the first down with third down coming up.
It's just really still confused that they haven't even targeted him once yet. I've been watching all game. Mississippi State is trying to do some things and take him away, but it's not like they're bracketing him or double covering him. It's just Nate Stanley, for whatever reason, is not on to his top target. That's a big loss. But Jamal Peters, the senior cornerback.
Chris Rayford backs him up.
Heads over to the sidelines.
Let's see if they go at Chris Rayford, the new guy that's just come in the game.
Hawkinson and 84, Nick Easley, their third down targets.
Got a trips left formation. They look that way, the pass complete. Let's look at the spot. They're going to spot it short. Abram knocked Easley out of bounds. And Abram is like, nope, it's not going to happen here. Fourth and about one to go.
It's a really good play by Jonathan Abram on the far sideline.
Did you go for it here?
As I mentioned, Nick Easley. I don't know, I kicked the field goal. I'll be honest with you. But Kirk Ferentz, it looks like he's going to roll the dice. Just haven't had much, if any, success running the football today. Field goal gives you the lead. I would kick it.
Let's look at what they've done. 16 of 24 on the season on fourth down. Little two-back set here in the offset eye. Little play fake. Stanley going to try and do it himself, and he will. First and goal, Hawkeyes.
Well, that's a tough play for Nate Stanley. A lot of people say he looks like Big Ben and the black and gold and the big 6'4", 243. Well, this play's kind of Big Ben-esque. Play action, nothing's there, and he's just going to make it happen. Get that big frame. He's not extremely fleet of foot, but he's tough to tackle, and it's a huge, crucial first down for this Iowa Hawkeye football team. Big-time play by the junior quarterback.
Stanley fires complete. No signal yet. Now touchdown. Nick Easley with his second. I tell you what, he got a great block from Kyle Gronewick.
That's why Kirk Ferentz is a model of consistency, and he's been doing it 20 years, and I'm up here in a booth. See, he goes for it, gets it, gets the touchdown. I love this play. Hold freezer right there, guys. He's going to work out. Watch the blocking on the outside, and a big-time touchdown for the Hawkeye offense.
Extra point is good. It's 24-19, and a very interesting third quarter. We've seen a little bit of everything. Easley with his first career two touchdown game.
Free kick, fair catch, the ball.
Hey, Chris Cotter. Hawkeyes with a 5-point lead after three quarters. Hawkeye fans, they've got a hunka burning love for their Hawkeyes. We'll be back, folks. 50 minutes to go. Thank you very much. Young forever. Got a good game. That's all we need at this point, right? You're watching the Outback Bowl, part of Capital One Bowl Mania. Look at the respective temperatures in Starkville, Iowa City, and we'd all rather be in Tampa right now. It's pretty simple, folks. Beautiful day, low humidity. Shout out to the people watching at Clearwater Beach. Harris Williams in the backfield on first down. Fitzgerald taking a shot on the post. Got it. First and goal at the one. Guidry with the catch. So the wide receivers finally make an indelible mark on this game. A 51-yard catch and run by Guidry.
Play action pass, and the protection was outstanding. They give plenty of time to Nick Fitzgerald to locate his wide receiver. They fake the toss. Great protection, and Stephen Guidry all alone running down the field, and a perfect pass by Nick Fitzgerald for a huge play for this offense.
Great way to start the fourth quarter. Fitzgerald keeps it, and they're going to lose a couple of yards. Anthony Nelson there. Second and goal coming up.
Nice job by Anthony Nelson staying square, not turning his shoulder, staying square and being able to make a good form tackle on the quarterback, Nick Fitzgerald. We've seen several times Nick Fitzgerald elude tacklers, run through arm tackles, but Anthony Nelson in perfect position.
Second and goal. Fitzgerald going to try and do it again. And stopped again. Loses another yard. Hesse there along with Nelson. So it's third and goal.
Parker Hesse, the senior, has meant so much. A true leader for this defense, stepping up and making a play. And Anthony Nelson, been a mainstay all year, steps up in on that tackle as well. Huge third down. See if this Iowa Hawkeye defense can bow their back and come up with a crucial stop.
Four receivers in on this formation. They spread out the defense again. Fitzgerald keeps it. He will make it. Fourth down. The Hawkeye defense intransigent once again. Non-negotiable. And in comes the field goal unit. A disconsolate head coach, Moorhead.
Well, this time it's Javon Colbert. Watch him come over the top. He's going to be the free hitter. He's going to work right over the top. He's going to come to balance. He's in perfect position to make the hit on Nick Fitzgerald. And then it's a host of Hawkeyes. Mm. Wow, what a stop by this Hawkeye defense up against the goal line to force this field goal.
Chrisman's already made two from 44 and 42. This one from 20. But you have to feel like the Hawkeyes got a win out of that sequence.
That's a big win.
Even though they give up the field goal. The big play was that catch by Guidry, 51 yards, and it's a two-point game. Welcome back, everyone, to the longest-running sponsored bowl game in bowl history, the 33rd edition of the Outback Bowl. Mississippi State and Iowa. I'll tell you what, I'll take a coconut shrimp over a bloomin' onion all day. Smith Marset on the kickoff return. And I've seen the way you devour food, partner. You're good.
Hey,
you're
man,
good.
I just want to know why we can't just enjoy both. Why's one got to be better than the other? I think it's all good.
Yeah, well, you know what? It's kind of the flavor down here. And I tell you what, if we have time after the game, I'll take you up on one of those. That's a Cuban sandwich. They make great ones, especially in Ybor City, which has a great reputation for food and wonderful Cuban heritage. Part of the migratory pattern that came up through the Caribbean and stopped here in the Tampa area.
If you're making lunch, I'm eating. I know that.
Oh, I'm buying. I'm not making.
Okay.
Iowa's offense trying to eat right now. Leading by two with 11:50 to go in the fourth quarter. Mark Jones, Dusty Dvorak, Molly McGrath down on the sidelines, and a happy new year from all of us at ESPN to all of you and your families wherever you might be. New York to LA to Norman, Oklahoma to Toronto, Canada to Miami, Florida, Stamford, Connecticut, New York, New York. That pass a little bit high and incomplete, intended for Sargent. So quickly it's third down for Nate Stanley. Described by his teammates, they'll be the first ones to tell you he's not very demonstrative, very quiet. But, you know, in playing behind C.J. Beathard for a couple of years, he learned the value of being able to express himself when need be. And he and Beathard maintain a pretty close relationship.
Very efficient down the stretch. We just showed you pictures of that thumb. He's been dealing with that thumb injury since way back in Penn State.
And where, oh, where is Hawkinson? No receptions today. Instead, they've gone Easley's way a lot, like they do there, out to the 30-yard line. Hawkinson was in blocking on that play.
Jonathan Abram once again flies in from out of the screen, making a play on Nick Easley, well short of the line to gain. Talked about chatting with him yesterday, how serious he is.
Yeah, with him, you know, the coaches tell us it's not ready, aim, fire. It's ready, fire, aim. He's one of those guys that thinks that it's better to ask for forgiveness instead of permission.
He's pulling the trigger every time, that's for sure.
Ball bounces out of bounds. Bulldogs will have good field position, trailing by 2 points, 10:33 to go. There's a look at Abram. You can tell that football matters to him. Football really is something at his core. And this might be the most calm and relaxed you might ever see him. He wears a cape of intensity every time he takes the field. Well, players from both teams got the opportunity to help lift the spirits of some of the youngsters on their visit to the children's wing of Tampa General Hospital. And Iowa Hawkeye fans down here waving in between quarters after the first quarter, as is the tradition at Iowa City and at Kinnick Stadium, when they all turn and wave to the children in the adjacent hospital back in Iowa. Pass is complete at the 31-yard line. What a grab by Osiris Mitchell. Wow.
That was an amazing catch. I just want to put a bow on the wave. It's the coolest thing that I've ever been a part of. When we were there earlier this year, had a chance to be a part of it at the end of the first quarter. Look at Osiris Mitchell, 6'5". Watch him go up and catch this football. High point it, strong hands, bring it in. Big time play down the sidelines for Osiris Mitchell. Been the best target and wide receiver for Fitzgerald this season.
On first down, Hill takes it over the left side. And a nice gain of about 7 yards. Well, we would be remiss if we didn't show you one of the signs made up from Tampa to the Children's Hospital, wishing all the young children there well. Getting better, and they do great things at that hospital up in Iowa City. Hawkeye fans making the trip. Second down and two. Hill again. Got enough for the first down. Forward progress going to be marked at about the 20-yard line. Got four on the play. Allen Hill getting up a little slowly. Naaman making the tackle. And
back here in Tampa, and a scary moment for Mississippi State's Kylan Hill. After a big hit, he collapsed on the sidelines. His eyes rolled into the back of his head. I was standing right there. He lost consciousness for a moment. Medical training staff awoke him. They tried to keep him alert as all of his teammates knelt beside him. He is now in the medical training tent. I will keep you updated as I know more now.
All right, Molly, the pass. Incomplete, intercepted in the end zone by Gervas. And he's bringing it back. What a turnaround. In and out of the arms, a touchdown catch potentially from Guidry, and the Hawkeyes have the football. That's his fourth interception of the season.
Well, Jake Gervas, the senior, he dropped an interception earlier. He's not going to drop this one as Stephen Guidry runs a post, and he flat out drops a touchdown, and Jake Gervas is the beneficiary of that with a huge interception and another Iowa Hawkeye turnover. Stephen Guidry, gonna be tough to get over that one. That ball hit him right in the chest and should have been a go-ahead touchdown here in the fourth quarter, Jonesy.
And all those number 30 t-shirts you see being worn in the stands, Gervas has some 90 friends and family members,
wow,
that have made the trip here to Tampa to watch him play. First and 10 coming back the other way. They lead by two. Hawkinson with his first target and his first catch, and still on his feet, hand walking, making it count.
A man said, why haven't you given me the football? This is what I can do. He had a chance. I mean, really nothing was there for him. But TJ Hawkinson refuses to go down. He's a talented, talented tight end who's tough. Little play action boot. Let's get the tight end out. Let's break one tackle. I'm going to break another couple of tackles, put my hand on the ground, keep my balance. Big time play for TJ Hawkinson, and the first target he's had all day long.
Made those 20 yards count. Near midfield, low snap. It came after Stanley, who completes it again to Hawkinson. Number 38 is in the mix. Him and Abram right there. And another first down, 22 yards on that catch.
That's good on good right there. Two quality players, 38 on 38, All-American on All-American, working out of the slot, just man-to-man coverage, quick out route, perfect timing by Nate Stanley finding his favorite target, and another Hawkeye first down.
Boy, Stanley did a nice job to corral that Aaron snap, too. gets it out quickly. Pass complete to Easley. And Easley takes it down to about the 26, picks up four. Time running with 7:10 to play. Hawkeyes leading by three.
Slow it down a little bit. Let that clock churn away.
Couple of 8-4 teams matched up. On second and six, Stanley finds his man out of the backfield, Sargent. And Sargent stopped. A couple of great quarterbacks in that game.
Fullback in. This is old school smash mouth, probably lead zone.
They line up out of the eye. Stanley's going to throw. And he throws it away. Incomplete. Smith Marset, the intended receiver. Fourth down coming up, and a dejected look from offensive coordinator Brian Ferentz.
Instead of the lead zone, they fake the lead zone. They boot action, and Nate Stanley's intended target was well covered. So Stanley just gets rid of the football out of bounds and see if those couple of big plays by TJ Hawkinson gets them close enough to get this field goal through.
Miguel Recinos made one earlier from 44. This one from 40. And he knocks it right through. Hawkeyes lead by five. Still a one-score game, though, for Mississippi State. But they might be without Kylan Hill the rest of the way. Great finish coming up here from Tampa in the 33rd edition of the Outback Bowl. And welcome back, everyone. Guidry on the sidelines. Had an opportunity a moment ago and had the ball bounce off his hands. Harris Williams.
Rolling on the field is an incomplete forward pass. Second down.
There's a good sign for Mississippi State. Kylan Hill, who Molly reported a moment ago, was being tended to, apparently seemed to lose consciousness for a moment after taking that big hit. Back up on his feet. They're going with Williams in the backfield now. He was an 1,100-yard rusher last season. On the draw. Nice run by Williams, about 2.5 yards short of the first down. Hankins making the tackle on the play. Still plenty of time for Mississippi State, but they've got to move with some brevity and expedience.
Receiver's got to help out the quarterback. Stevie Guidry's had a couple of drops today. When Nick Fitzgerald puts it on the money, got to make this Hawkeye defense pay.
So Guidry is stretching out his hamstrings a moment ago. Got to make sure the legs are working so the hands do as well. Nowhere to go for Williams. Hockaday right there to make the tackle.
It's a big
under
time,
5 minutes to go.
It's a big time play by Jack Hockaday. Coming downhill. Harris Williams, a physical running back. But you got to bring your hat and shoulders. Nice job initially by the defensive line. Parker Hesse gets outside, and Jack Hockaday finishes him off and forces the punt. Huge stop by this Hawkeye defense once again. Phil Parker has got to be ecstatic about the way this defense has played, the turnovers they've forced, and put them in position to win this game.
Low snap. Tucker Day with another great punt. Wow. All the way back to the 12-yard line is Groneweg. And good coverage by Mississippi State. He had a 70-yard punt earlier. This one goes for 54 with 4:06 to go. On first down, they're going to keep it on the ground. Sargent, yeah, with a name like Hawkinson, you're destined to be a Hawkeye.
It's a great
for maybe
point.
An extra year.
Exactly right.
At least they're hoping that in Iowa City. When you talk about Hawkinson, they've had a great lineage and procession of talented tight ends. Hawkinson actually speaks with Dallas Clark, former Indianapolis Colt and Hawkeye, and who they have a great relationship with.
Look at this year. You got one guy who might be a first-round pick and the other one, the Mackey. So as talented as they've always been at tight end, this might be the most talent they've had in one season.
On second and five, out to the edge to Easley. Gain of about two. How do you figure that this program, Iowa, has become like a tight end U when you look at the number of guys they've had come through?
Well,
done great.
Well, I think that, you know, product of the offense, right? Because they throw to their tight ends. I mean, you got to be able to block when you come to Iowa, and they play action pass, they utilize the tight end. And don't forget, Brian Ferentz, he was the tight ends coach at New England. Mm. So since he's come back, I think an even bigger emphasis on continually having the tight ends, father and son there.
Huge third down coming up. If they hang on to the ball, it really gets difficult for Mississippi State. The pass is short of the first down to Hawkinson, complete. So fourth down coming up, the clock running with 2:33 to go. Mississippi State.
Mississippi State
burning its final timeout.
30 seconds.
Take me inside the minds of the respective coaches. First of all, let's deal with Mississippi State. They're about to get the football back.
Well, Mississippi State, they're going to have to hit some plays down the field. No timeouts left. You need chunk plays, big plays, which this offense can do. 63 plays this year of 20-plus yards, so that's part of the Joe Moorhead offense. Like I said earlier, when opportunities present themselves, you're going to have to catch the football, but they need some chunk plays in the throw game. I think if you're Iowa, keep everything in front. Don't let anybody back behind you. Field goal doesn't win it for Mississippi State. They got to get in the end zone, and they got to get six.
And they're going to start from their own 31-yard line.
And what I think about as we get ready for this final drive, Nick Fitzgerald, the senior, his final drive possession as the Mississippi State Bulldog on the other side, Parker Hesse, Jake Gervais, these seniors, you want to go out on top? Who's going to make the plays?
Fitzgerald fires complete. And a catch made by Green.
And a great job keeping him in bounds. Clock's going to continue to roll. Excellent job by Amani Hooker making the tackle and keeping the ball carry in bounds. And Kylan Hill unexpectedly back in the game.
He's one of the best weapons. He gets a touch here. Turns it upfield, got the first down, and lucid enough to get out of bounds and stop the clock with 1:54 to go.
He's one of their dynamic playmakers with the football. Will swing pass out in the flats and make somebody miss, and he hits the sidelines and very intelligently steps out, stop the clock.
7-yard gain, 1:54 to go. Fitzgerald over the middle into traffic. And incomplete, intended for Osiris Mitchell. Hankins broke it up. Iowa used to these situations, especially throughout the second half of the season. Three of their losses by a total of 13 points. Trying to end up on the right side of the ledger this time.
And they kind of figured things out in that final game, winning a 31-28 down to the wire game against Nebraska. See if that pushes him to the finish line here today.
Fitzgerald gives it to Hill. Not much room and no timeouts remaining. The clock is going to keep running here. A gain of three.
Interesting decision there by Mississippi State. Hand the ball off. Clock's running. Very minimal gain. Now Nick Fitzgerald has got to go fast.
Fitzgerald open over the middle, caught at the 36-yard line. That's Dedrick Thomas. Moves the chains, 1:19 to go, a 15-yard pickup.
Excellent job by Nick Fitzgerald, surveying the field, going through his progressions, and finding an open Dedrick Thomas in the middle of the field.
Towards the sidelines, he's going to burn one. Throws it away and stops the clock with 1:04 to go.
Legal number two is in the area.
I was going to say.
Second down.
They say, was that intentional grounding? Yeah. But Dedrick Thomas was over there on the far sidelines.
Hockaday was there applying the pressure up front for Iowa's defense. Second and 10, 1:04 to go. No timeouts remaining for Joe Moorhead and Nick Fitzgerald. They've got some deep threats with Guidry and Mitchell. Fitzgerald just got rid of it, and incomplete. Mitchell was there, but good pressure up front by Neiman. There he is, number 49.
And that's exactly right. That's what they're gonna do. They're just gonna bring pressure right up the middle with the linebacker, go man-to-man coverage. No one picks him up. Nice job sidestepping by Nick Fitzgerald, but unable to locate Osiris Mitchell. Phil Parker doesn't blitz a lot. He picks his spots. Nice job bringing the pressure and forcing the ball out quick.
Third and 10. Out to Aris Williams. Got to get out of bounds. He won't. 48 seconds, clock running. Fitzgerald signaling to spike it when they get to the line of scrimmage.
But he can't spike it. It's fourth down. He can't spike it. Amani Hooker just made a heck of a play. He was covered two guys at one time, and then he keeps leverage outside, forces him in bounds. Here's the ball game.
Fourth and 5. Got rid of it. Incomplete. Javos broke it up. And that should do it.
Well, this Hawkeye defense has been the backbone of this team all year, leading the Big Ten in scoring defense. They've been stingy. They've come up with big plays all day, created turnovers, and ultimately it's a senior, Jake Javos, who gets a pass breakup that's eventually going to win them this Outback Bowl championship.
Really didn't have a chance on that one. As Iowa will snap their two-game losing streak in the Outback Bowl. They'll get the win. Simmons will catch him on Sundays.
Yeah, you'll catch him on Sundays. Good effort by Jeffrey Simmons and Mississippi State. This is a heck of a football game. I know a lot of people tell me that nobody cares about bowl games anymore. You tell me these guys out there on the field right now don't care about this game. A lot of emotion, a lot of passion on the face of these Hawkeye and Bulldog players.
And Molly is downstairs with Jake Javos.
Thank you so much, Mark. Jake, you had an interception. You had that huge bat down to end the game. What was your mentality in this final game as a Hawkeye?
You know, this is a big team win for us. Offense, defense, special teams came out and fought. We prepared hard all month. We just came out and executed. And we knew for, you know, 13 seniors, the last time we were going to be playing together. So we came out, got after, and played the full 60.
You had around 90 people here, friends and family. How did it feel for you to make such a big impact in front of your loved ones?
It's awesome, you know. All the credit goes to my coaches and my teammates, but like you said, I got about 88 people over in section 122, made the trip, and just be able to go out with a win, having them here is really special.
You were emotional on the sidelines trying to fire up your teammates. How does it feel to walk off this field your last time in this uniform as a winner?
It's big time. You know, we want to finish the season. We knew there'd be ups and downs. It's a really good team, really well coached. We fought the full 60 and finished the fight.
All right, congratulations on the win.
Thank you very much.
Mark, back to you.
All right, Molly. Consistency, which is the hallmark, the signature of the Iowa Hawkeyes program for the last 20 years under Kirk Ferentz. They win it 27-22, and what a day it was. Folks, stay tuned for NFL Live presented by KFC. Happy New Year from all of us to all of you. For Molly McGrath, for Dusty Dvorak, the entire J crew, I'm Mark Jones saying so long, everybody, as we go back to the studio.